go, the eve of the second rest day, staying on the Adriatic coastline today, and this will be a fairly routine stage, except we have a little bit of a drag up to the finishing line.
Well, certainly a little bit more testing than it has been over the last couple of days. The riders zigzagging across the bottom of the peninsula here, thinking about turning up towards the north, which will happen in a couple of days' time. I think it'll be a tricky course, but it should be the sort of day where a breakaway could succeed.
As we join the action, indeed, that has been the case. After 52 kilometres today, 16 riders are clear, and none of them affecting the destiny of the Maglia Rosa, and that is probably why they're hanging on to just on 3.5 minutes advantage. So the winner, I think, is going to come from this group.
Well, it's a group that got away very early on. This is a move here by Axel Merckx. You recognise the big longiline figure of Axel, who said he's going to retire at the end of this season. And he's been around for a long time. It's been a difficult career for Axel Merckx, having to live up to the name that he's carried on those shoulders of his. But you know, despite the fact that his father, Eddie Merckx, was the greatest cyclist of all times, I have to say that I think Axel has got himself a fairly good little palmarès.
He has. He won a stage of the Giro d'Italia back in 2000 as well, the same year he was 5th in Liège-Bastogne-Liège and 12th in the Olympic Games. So yes, he is a good cyclist by any measure. 13 wins to his career, but I have to tell you, none this year yet. It might be all about to change. This is the remnants of that breakaway group. 15 riders in this group, including Benoit Jochim, Sylvain Calzati, Franco Pellissotti, the English rider, Charles Vergelius is in here as well. But as I say, none of them likely to endanger Basso's pink jersey.
Well, I'll tell you what, they're not very far off the back wheel of Axel Merckx going around that hairpin bend there. I make it Axel's advantage at around about 50 metres. Possibly. There's Axel just around the corner there, but he's a strong rider. He has the ability to survive. He made this move actually on the descent before the riders started this climb.
Well, if he can just hang on here, he's not far from the finish, but it's looking as though he might have a little bit of a problem here. Good tempo riding being ridden at the back of the group. It's Jon Horic of Case de Pan who's setting the pace in the chase there.
Look at his face. I remember a few years ago, Axel getting a stage victory in the Giro d'Italia on a descent on the run into the finish line. His father was commentating at the time for Belgian television, and he was almost in tears and unable to speak.
Yes, I remember that, actually. 4 hours and 38 minutes, and Merckx isn't going to make it because it was a good try. He went going down the hill, but they've caught him going up the hill at four. Well, they haven't caught him yet, and it's 300 metres to go. It's going to be touch and go.
Well, he may well just pull it off. There's Case de Pagna on the front, just keeping it nice and tidy, trying to pull him back up. They've really got themselves organised. Are they going round? They're slowly pulling back to Axel Merckx. I can just see Charlie Vergelius just sitting at the back of this group.
That's a good ride by the man with the long, thin legs from Great Britain. But they're right on him, and that's Pellissotti who's trying to get up to him as well. The leaky gas rider just tailing the rider from Crédit Agricole off the back. That's Poilvé.
Oh, they're on him. They're right on his wheel now. That's it for Axel Merckx.
Well, his desperate efforts, desperate effort. Look at that. Just about 100 metres from the finish. How unlucky is that? And Pellissotti's got his chance here now. You always recognise him with his long, curly locks. Pellissotti's done it, and yes, it's me. And he's got it ahead of the sprinter, Vladimir Efekin, the Russian rider on Case de Pan. And I'm not sure who was third there, but it looked like the Liberty Seguros rider, Yakovlev, who's got third.
Pellissotti is a man who a number of years ago was regarded as the revelation of Italian cycling way back in 2001. He finished 20th in the Vuelta a España that year, and everybody thought he was going to be the next big thing. Back down in the main field, it looks as if Team Lamprey are trying to sort something out, and again, maybe trying to do something for their man, Damiano Cunego. Cunego, Phil, of course, will be looking for a few time bonuses, but they've all been wiped away here this afternoon.
Yeah, it's just crossing the line there, Sylvain Calzati. He's going to come over just at the tail end of those breakaway riders. He was in the breakaway. This is the main field now on the line. They're going to come in over 3 minutes back, so there's big gains for those boys up front, but I don't think there's anybody going to be concerned about that. There's the most disappointing man of the day, Axel Merckx.
Well, I actually can't understand why the main field is attacking this climb quite so hard, unless, of course, Damiano Cunego and the guys from Lamprey believe they may well create a bit of a surprise and a split in the field, and that's the only way. You see Ivan Basso just riding up there. He looks very comfortable. He's just being helped there by his teammate. Looks like the style of Jens Voigt keeping him up to the front, and there are the kilometre banner right now.
And it looks as though Axel Merckx has broken down there. Real sadness dawning on him. That's a real shame, that. But that's, I don't suppose Franco Pellissotti is going to be saying that at all.
He won't be too worried either, will he? Franco Bellizzotti getting himself the win, just catching Axel Merckx inside of the last 200 metres or so.
This is, I think that's Charlie Wegelius coming in, isn't it?
Yeah, he must have really got tailed off towards the running. Yep. He was in the group at the bottom of the climb. I saw him just on the back of the group.
He was.
And then all of a sudden, I think he just decided he wasn't going to get himself the win this afternoon, but his team got the win at least.
Well, that's the old tale. Once the elastic snaps, it snaps, and that's it. You just get home as best you can. Now, Basso is making no mistakes here. He's just gone to the front now, and he's calmed the whole situation down. Paolo Savardelli's got his back wheel at least, maybe having a better day today. Maybe he's riding himself in to put in a challenge when we get up into the high mountains.
And this is big Jens Voigt on the front.
He's amazing.
Completely changed his programme this season because he and Bobby Julich have decided that the way they want to ride this season is to peak at the Giro d'Italia and, of course, a little later in the month of July for the Tour de France, because they know that their man Ivan Basso is going to try and win both of these races. A very difficult feat, but at the moment it seems to be paying for Jens Voigt because he's looking very strong on the front of the main field. And they've split the peloton, actually.
Yeah, well, Voigt does that with his tempo riding. Look at this now. He's just giving all his energy to his team leader, and it looks as though Savardelli riding very calmly up there. One name, by the way, that we know has gone out today, Bradley McGee. He'll be sad about that, but he doesn't seem to be riding well, and he's going to go away and try and sort out whatever the problem is.
Well, Brad's had a very difficult time finding any kind of form this season, and nobody really knows what the problem is, but I'm sure with the doctors available these days, he will find out. This is Paolo Bettini leaping out of the front, but this is more a question of pride than anything else, because I don't think there are any points available for him and the Chiclamina jersey race.
The little cricket, as they call him, Il Grillo, is having no trouble whatsoever. They're still fighting for it as he comes over the line. Just about getting it in the end, and that will have been José Gutiérrez right up alongside him. But the whole peloton timed in at around 3 minutes 20 seconds, and there shouldn't be any change in the immediate heads of the leaderboard. There's the man who stole the day, Franco Pellizzotti, tied it to perfection, and it was just 100 metres too long for poor old Axel Merckx.
Great win by Pellizzotti. He must have wondered whether or not he must need to really say a big thank you also to the Case d'Epagne riders. There's the point when Axel Merckx looks over his shoulders and he knows now that he's not going to get the win. Pellizzotti sees the moment, goes immediately on the attack, accelerates over the last, well, it's not much more than 100 metres to get himself the win, and that is very sad for Axel Merckx because he was just that far away from getting himself the win.
And Francisco Perez is the Case d'Epagne rider at the bottom of the picture. He comes in there as well. But there we are. Pellizzotti gets the Vels Efekim, Yakovlev. So well, that's confirmed. Yakovlev, Liberty Seguros, DuPont getting the fourth place finish. Good ride there by Hubert DuPont, AG2R. New rider on the team. But Pellizzotti enjoying celebrating as all Italians do when they win a stage of their home tour.
Well, there
overall, there shouldn't be any change.
Shouldn't be any change at all in the overall classification, and there isn't. Still a minute and 34 advantage for Ivan Basso. He must be feeling fairly comfortable because after the rest day, we're all lining up for a very important individual time trial. But Pellizzotti, with that move today, clocked up into the top 10.
Yeah, it's gone over the top of Savardelli, who's also looking good back in the So it was a breakaway that mattered, although they won't see Pellizzotti as a man to worry about. Certainly Ivan Basso will not be worrying about the stage winner today. The second and final rest day now behind the riders. We move on to stage number 11, the first big time trial of the race. 50 kilometres, and we stay in the home of the Vespa scooter, Pontedera.
Well, it'll be an important day for Ivan Basso. He has really improved his time trialling ability over the last couple of seasons. He spent a lot of time in the wind tunnel to try and get himself as aerodynamic as possible. And for him, he could find himself extending his overall lead over everybody else. This, though, is Jan Ullrich. The time to beat is Marco Pinotti, a time of 59 minutes and 49 seconds. And Phil, just have a look at this. Ullrich has done nothing so far this season. And out of the time checks on the course, he's been very fast.
Well, he's in the mid-50s overall, almost 20 minutes behind Ivan Basso, and hoping he can turn the form around for the Tour de France. But right now, Jan Ullrich looks as though he's proving what we know he has, that great time-trialing ability. He's going to have an awful long wait if he's planning on winning the stage, because the rest of the riders are all behind him on the course. But it looks as though he'll get the fastest time here. He's a minute to the good. Jan Ulrich is now going to sit back and wait for well in excess of an hour and a half.
Well, that's a 51 kilometre an hour average speed. So now he's beating Marco Pinotti by a minute and 1 second. And going back to third place, we're looking at 2 minutes and 2 seconds. Last man to start in the Maglia Rossa, Ivan Basso, concentrated, waiting for his time to start. 15 seconds for this man before he pulls away from the starting ramp, and that is a picture of relaxed concentration.
Well, let's see how much he has improved now. He's got a nice little buffer there. We shouldn't see a change in the leaderboard by the end, at least as far as the pink jersey is concerned, because he's built his time up out on the course. Will he lose some of his advantage today? That's what the riders are hoping now. He starts off last of the 184 survivors of this year's Giro d'Italia.
Well, he knows the time to beat, and the time that he needs to beat, of course, is the time of Jan Ulrich. But don't forget, as we look here at big Jens Voigt coming up here, actually catching his teammate there, Larsen. Yeah. Jens Voigt is actually putting in a fairly fine performance, but I think for Basso, he must remember that last year he was the winner of the final time trial in the Giro d'Italia after having that very nasty ride through the mountains.
So Voigt is riding yet what we expect from him, a very good solid time trial. This man gives his all in every type of discipline of the world of cycling, and he's coming up to the line. He's challenging the time of Larsen, and he's going to beat that, so he's going to slot in third place at the moment. Back out on course, Paolo Savadelli, who won the prologue. This is a whole different ball game at 50 kilometres.
It's actually a little bit of a weak spot for Paolo Savadelli. He's good at the explosive prologue time trials because he's a man who really has the ability to handle his machine around the corners. And when riders lose time in the corners, Paolo Savadelli actually makes it up. He looks fairly comfortable. For me, he's sitting just a little bit too high and taking a lot of wind into his chest. Here's the world time trial champion, Michael Rogers. Not really performing well. You know, over the last couple of seasons in these big Grand Tour time trials, Michael Rogers has really not been the time trialist that he should be.
No, that's not a great ride by Michael, but, you know, he has other duties on T-Mobile and he's not riding good time trials now, so he's not going to concentrate on that discipline this year, and I think he'll probably lose that title at the end of the year. But there's the situation at the moment. Ulrich still sitting pretty. That's a big name that's come in now and not affected his position. Paolo Savadelli riding well, but we need to judge his time against Basso, not against Jan Ulrich right now.
Well, Jens Voigt has actually slotted into third place at the finish at the moment, but a lot of big names still to come. Now a time check at 14.5 kilometres. And Ivan Basso is not rivaling the top times here at all, Phil, and that is a bit of a surprise to me. But, you know, it's always very strange when you come into a race like this the day after a rest day. A lot of these riders, especially the man who's had the pink jersey, this is Alessandro Petacchi.
Well, this is poor Alessandro Petacchi. Come to see the boys, not looking at all good there with that injured knee. I'm surprised he's even allowed up on the crutches. This is Savadelli at kilometre 28, and he's running midfield, top 20, just about a minute 32 down on the time of Jan Ulrich at that point.
Well, Petacchi, you know, that injury to his knee that he sustained before the race even got down to Italy is a very nasty injury. And I know, Phil, that it's going to take him a long time to get back. This is Ivan Basso. He's climbing up at kilometre 28. He's improving. He's taken a very steady start and realises the second part of the race is where you can pull time back. But for him, he's not thinking about Jan Ulrich, really. He's thinking more about Gilberto Simoni and, of course, Salvadelli.
Well, he's less than a minute on Ulrich now, 58 seconds. And more importantly, he's getting time on his immediate rivals, and he's got the advantage of sweeping from the back. Here's Tommy Danielson challenging seventh place. Good ride by Tom Danielson. Very good ride indeed. He stays in seventh at the moment. That's a good ride by Tom Danielson, because really so far he's been in the race to help Paolo Savadelli. Here's Sergei Gonchar. He'll be a good guide.
Well, this is an interesting style. He's a powerful rider, Gonchar. He's won time trials in the Giro d'Italia before, and look at the way he's all over that machine. It has to be the worst time trialing position in the world, but you know what? It is effective for him.
Pure brute strength. Marco Pinotti sitting second here, and that means that, in fact, Honchard behind his team captain Ulrich at this point. Yes, he has. He's won five time trial stages. The only stages ever won in the Giro d'Italia over the years have all been time trials. and Conchar racing up to the line, still challenging second place here. It's an awful long way up, that huge gear, he stamps on it all of the way, just about holds a straight line, slipped into third but gets the better of Jens Voigt. Conchar holds third.
But look at the time gap. He's lost almost a minute to his teammate Jan Ullrich. That's an indication that Ullrich now is starting to get himself back on form for a challenge to win the Tour de France in the month of July. Salvadelli is also not putting in a bad performance here. Not so fast at the early time checks, but it's the last time check that counts, and he's going to slip inside the top four.
Well, Basso is showing the advantage over Salvadelli. Basso is the last man to finish, but Salvadelli for the moment is fourth. 1 minute 19 conceded to Ullrich. That's not important. It's how much will he concede to Ivan Basso. That's the situation just now. Pinotti still holds second. Honchar, Savadelli into fourth. Voigt from third down to fifth right now. And here's the man who could reshape the classification yet again as he starts to line up for the finish.
Well, there he is, and he's just zigzagging all over the road, 191. And I think he's caught to Damiano Cunego. Cunego, not a great individual time trialist. He's got a lot to learn. It's his weak spot, but he can climb mountains very well, as you can see. The man in the pink jersey there just deciding which way is he going to go round this final corner, dropping down. Fairly technical, the run into the finish line.
Well, what a magnet this is now as we go back to the finishing line here. Gutierrez is coming up towards it. Another solid ride. It's going to keep him up on the leaderboard, but it's not going to win in the time trial. He's now looking at Voigt. He'll get the better of Voigt. He'll come in now in fifth place. Ullrich sits on top, looking very much the winner here. Basso looks likely to be the bridesmaid because he's gone past Cunego.
Well, this is the time that he's got to beat. The time of Jan Ullrich has gone by now. He's looking now to make sure, and I think he has actually gained time on everybody else who is challenging him in the top five in the overall classification. Cunego has already lost himself 2 minutes, but this is his weak spot. Look at the gap between those two riders. It's more than 2 minutes he's actually going to lose. Yep. There he will stop the clock in second place there.
Well,
28 seconds down on Jan Ullrich.
And therefore is going to increase his overall lead in the Giro d'Italia in the time trial, the event he has improved at thanks to the specialist training done in the camp of Bjarne Riis. Cunego is going to feel very upset about that performance today, conceding time big time. There's the result of the stage. He conceded only 28 seconds. Boy, he really caught up Jan Ullrich in that last 30 kilometres. Pinotti third, Honchar fourth. Some big time trial names there, giving best to Ivan Basso, who slots in second place. But the big man is back. The Kaiser is on the winner's podium. He's never more happier, and his form en route towards the upcoming Tour de France.
Well, you have to wonder if he did that and lost a bit of time over the last couple of days just so that he could come out and challenge. And look at these time gaps now for Ivan Basso. Scary.
Enormous. 2:48 back to Gutierrez. And then you go 3:24 to third place. 5:38 to Tom Danielson, though despite that, is sitting there in fifth place overall. Those are huge time gaps, even though there is still a very long way to go, and dare I say it, all of the real mountains are still to come. Livorno to Sestri Levante, over 160 kilometres. It's a Friday in the Giro d'Italia, and there is one big hill towards the end.
A little bit more testing for the riders. The start of the race was pretty much alongside the coast, but down towards the end, it really does get lippy. As you can see, the undulations down towards there, and it's a very dangerous descent down into the town of Sestri Levante.
Well, not surprisingly, after the time trial, there has been a breakaway most of the day after only 8 kilometres. These are the survivors of it at the moment. Eduardo Sella is in this, as well as Vladimir Belli. None of them affecting the destination of Ivan Basso's Maglia Rossa. And so they're free to fly. The peloton was last checked at over 8 minutes back.
Well, the main field, I think, Phil, just deciding to take a little... Oh, the problem here, this is Sella.
Ouch! And that Sella, what a painful accident that is, right along the edge of the barrier, and that's Mori who's disappeared down the edge.
Well, I don't know what happened there. They were both going to, in fact, he's gone right down the edge, and he's done a bit of a Lance Armstrong there because he's cut off the corner.
Well, I don't think the commissaires will penalise him for that. And here comes Sella around the corner, and he'll pick up Mori on the descent. Yes, it's quite a steep drop down there.
Quite a steep drop down there, but I think they've both got back up and are running.
Well, back up towards the leaders now. And there, this is Sella still trying to get back on terms, I think. This has been a very rough ride for these guys today. Also up here is Manuela Mori. Baliani is here.
Well, that's actually Baliani trying to get off the front there in the jersey at 1.8 kilometres to go. He's a man who we've seen many times in the past be aggressive like this, but hardly ever has he come up with a victory.
This is Horwich here also, and sitting on behind him is Addy Engels, I think, who's just come up. This is the survivors of the breakaway. They've split up on that descent where we saw the crash. They're now trying to get back on terms here, and they're going to have to try and answer all these attacks, because the two leaders, Baliani, went for it, and it looks as though they've finally nailed him back there. He's looking over. He's having a very good Giro d'Italia at the moment, Baliani.
Well, that's Horwich there in the black jersey of Castepagna Lil Baleares. The orange jersey is Fortunato Baliani. He's the man on the front looking over his shoulder. That's Addy Engels in second position, and you can just see across the road there the kilometre to go. Engels has made the move. Good move by Engels. They're trying to respond. They've got to get right onto his wheel. Baliani's the man making the effort.
Well, there's six of them got back together here. There were eight. Six of them have got back for the sprint now. And this is going to be an awful long... It's not really a sprint at all. It's desperation by all of the riders here. Sitting here at the back is Mori, the man that went off the edge of that climb. And that is a final attack here by Juan Horwich. He's chosen it just right because of all the people in this group. He wasn't the real sprinter, but they're all at the top level of their effort, and I think they've let the winner slip away. He's right on the left of the road.
Well, Baliani's a man on the front trying to pull it back together. Emmanuel Sella is just at the back here in the orange jersey. He's clawed his way back into this break, but surely he hasn't got enough energy left to try and make a counter move. This is Horwich. You know, I don't think he's had a win so far this season, but this could be the one at 350 metres to go.
I'll tell you what, Paul, he hasn't had a win since 2003, so he's really welcome back to the winner's podium. And this will be the biggest win of his career, which began in the year 2000 as well. He's now a winner of the Giro d'Italia. You can't believe it, but it's him, and he's won the stage here. 32 years of age, the biggest win of his life. He's got 10 in all in his career. And there's the battle for second place. Addy Engels just getting it on the line. Emmanuel Sella and Mori, the two fallers, taking third and fourth.
Well, that was a very strange descent, I have to say, going down there. Sella had to really pull himself back into that race. He would have been a man with a chance of getting the victory, but you have to say the man who timed it to perfection really was Horwich.
Well, the crash to Sella, I'm surprised he got back up and was able to get a place at all, because it looked ever so painful running along the rim of that crash barrier. Looking a bit further down now as they all come up to the line. This is the remnants of the original breakaway, and Sven Kraus will be the Gerolsteiner rider there. And Ongarato, who's finally given up trying to win the bunch sprints, at him on the left trying to go for the group sprint. Is he going to get it? It'll be tough if he's going to get it all the way, but I don't think he is. Well, may have just pipped on the... May have just got it on the line, or he may have just been behind Sven Kraus there.
And that was Tricky Beltran just coming up in last position from that group as well. He too, I think, is looking for the breakaways here now in the Giro d'Italia. This is the main field. I'm just looking down to see Ivan Basso was riding comfortably at the front end of the peloton. And just at the back here at number eight is Chechu Rubiera, one of the riders from Discovery Channel.
More or less the peloton coming in here. A few riders off the back, but they're going to concede at least 7 minutes. It's still a fair way to go. By the way, today not starting Philippe Gilbert and Michael Rasmussen, the King of the Mountains in last year's Tour de France. And sadly for Ireland too, Mark Scanlon, also amongst the riders who have abandoned today.
Against Voigt right at the front, they're still chasing pretty hard, these guys. There's not much reason to, because there's not really much left to fight out. Almost 7 minutes has gone by since those riders crossed the line.
And looking at the size of that peloton, it is a very select group of maybe 40 riders, no more than that. So there's an awful lot of riders losing big time, but I suspect that all of the men that matter are in this group as they cross the line 7 minutes down. Paolo Bettini it was, I think, getting the bunch sprint.
Yep, I recognise the golden helmet, and there you can see Horwich gets the confirmation. 5 seconds ahead of Addy Engels and Emmanuel Sella in third place. Vladimir Belli taking up the rear in sixth.
And the peloton timed in at 7 minutes and 3 seconds, and it was headed home by 13th place Paolo Bettini, but there is the winner. The 10th ever win of his career, and the first one of any real significance. The man on the left determined to get into the shot. Well done, sir.
Well, it won't do anything at all to change the top end of the overall classification, because still Ivan Basso now looking very solid. Although Emmanuel Sella with that ride today has climbed his way up into the top four, and Belli has climbed up into the top five.
Pelosotti disappeared off the leaderboard there, but Basso doesn't care. He's still got all the time he wants here. He can't chase everybody, neither should he just now. Ivan Basso enjoying his moments as leader of the Giro d'Italia. Still a long way to go. Fast one. Another long stage, 218 kilometres, as we race towards that rather nasty climb on the far right of your picture.
Well, the riders today moving through the area of Piemonte before heading up to the Vallo d'Aosta, and it is a very difficult race finish because it is a tough mountain finish when the riders get up to the Passo Piccolo San Bernardo, which has got a very interesting ski resort at the top, but I'm not sure there's going to be two guys clipping on the skis this afternoon. Maybe the crampons for one or two.
Is the area at the start, Sella, who's climbed up into fourth place overall now. Luciano there as well, the winner yesterday. Everybody all smiles, the sun continues to shine on the Italians.
Well, Paolo Bettini looking as if he's got the Ciclamina jersey on. And this is Paolo Salvadelli. Damiano Cunego signing a few autographs.
Well, the reason he's got the Ciclamino jersey on, in fact, McEwen, Paul, has decided not to start this stage.
Well, the news must have got around pretty fast because he was very quickly into the Ciclamino jersey, and he'll be a difficult man to dethrone from that because he has been Mr. Consistent since the very start of the Giro. There he is, the golden helmet, just having a quick chat there to Giovanni Lombardi.
Also noting, by the way, amongst non-starters, T-Mobile's Michael Rogers also didn't start, so the two Australians heading back into Europe. Away from Italy. The mountains are around us, they won't get into them just yet. Although it's a little bit tough towards the finish today, La Tuile.
At ski resort.
That's what it's like at the finish, the snow's still on the tops and it's very, very cold.
And humid as well, a dampness coming over the race this afternoon. A lot of these riders will be worrying about this, and as you can see, all of the spectators pretty much wrapped up against the cold here. Immagini dall'arrivo. These are pictures from the finishing line here this afternoon. Although it's cold, everybody seems pretty happy to be accepting the arrival of the Giro d'Italia.
Well, the Piccolo San Bernardo, that's the pass they climbed to the finish today. It's absolutely freezing up here, and they've had a fair bit of rain as well, and it's still looking as though it's going to come down. These are the riders now on the lower slopes of the climb as they come up, and it is, in fact, Leonardo Pipoli who is in the picture here. This is the top of the Colle San Carlo, kilometre 211 of 216.
Well, I think Pipoli today must have been given a free hand because normally we've seen him looking after Gilberto Simoni, but here he is with the Maglia Rossa Ivan Basso. We get a time check over who are the chasers, looking a little bit further down.
I think that's only right, because Pipoli has been riding superbly for Simoni and he seems to have been the stronger of the two. He's now being given his chance here to try and get at least a stage win. Simone's trying to cope with Basso at the moment, not doing a bad job. Look at this weather.
Look at the snow. Now, I tell you what, Sella is taking a few risks on the descent here, Phil, and Ivan Basso seems to be backing off a fraction, and that's not really surprising. Pipoli is a fairly long way down in the overall classification, and in the pink jersey, Ivan Basso knows that a crash at a point like this could cause him to lose all chances. He's very scared on this descent.
I'm not surprised. It is glacial on this descent here, and I don't blame him. With all the time he's got in hand, there's no reason to take risks.
Well, I think what he will try and do, Phil, is just limit his losses on this descent. And, you know, we're still counting back to the next group on the road, and this is the next group on the road, and they haven't reached the summit yet. That will be Gutiérrez there. I expect that will be Simoni in the yellow, and they've lost themselves now more than a minute on the two leaders.
Well, I can't believe that they've allowed Basso to get away again, which indicates that Basso is simply too strong for these guys. Gutiérrez has been left floundering, so too Simoni. We haven't seen Cunego at all. He was with them at the start of the climb. He's obviously been tailed on it. This is Basso now on the way down, glacial as it may be. He is now putting time into his major rivals, people he won't see as a big challenger.
1 minute and 24 seconds. The clock stopped on Gutiérrez and Gilberto Simoni, and this man is certainly not taking any risks at all. That is Caruso there. I'm not sure who the other guy is with the raincoat on, but I'm sure we'll get an idea of him once we start to go down the descent.
Well, we'll check on him. It's a Sella Italia rider, is it? No, we can't tell, really, can we? It could be Vladimir Belli. But anyway, Pipoli is still the man we haven't seen much of, but he is still in front. The clock is counting on him.
Well, we're looking there at about 2 minutes and 5 seconds for the next two guys. That is Caruso, the Liberty Seguros rider, riding a very solid Giro d'Italia. Ivan Basso deciding not to take any risks at all, not wanting to stay at all with Pipoli. In fact, Pipoli has completely flown the coop here. He's taken all kinds of risks on this descent, knowing probably that Ivan Basso won't take the risks to stay with him.
Well, our camera's staying with Basso, rightly so. because if he does fall, he'll at least be on television when it happens, but he's taking no chances. It's going to feel very, very tortuous down there because those brakes aren't going to be gripping too well on the descent. These are the days you always get at least one day like this in any Giro d'Italia. At least there's no snow yet as they continue the way down. The clock again, you see, Paul, the time gaps are enormous.
Well, they're huge, and I don't think anybody really expected to have a showdown like this. Just looking down to see who the next guy is. It's a Case de Pagna. That Lamprey rider is probably a Damiano Cunego. He was riding very well in the early part of this race. And again, we go back to Ivan Basso, precariously picking his way around these corners. What is very difficult on a day like this as well, when the rain and cold comes down, is actually controlling the brakes. And if you do overbrake, then all that happens is you'll lock up the wheels and you go down so easily on these very slippy roads.
Well, that looked like a Case de Pagna rider on the course. Well, they're a long way down if they are. We've got none in the front six riders so far. Basso now running slightly off the mountain and driving on, knowing that with every pedal rev, he's likely increasing his overall lead here. He still hasn't got on to people here. In fact, he's only 35 seconds behind him. Basso 1.5 minutes back to Simoni. So, boy, when he got away, he flew away from Simoni.
Well, Simoni, I think, may well make a bit of a comeback on the descent, because Gilberto Simoni, alongside Paolo Salvadelli, is one of the best descenders in the main field. But this man, Ivan Basso, does not have to take any risks at all. He has 35 seconds between himself and Leonardo Pipoli. And I think, really, he's not too worried about that. All he's trying to do at the moment is just limit his losses and increase his time gap over everybody else in this race who he feels are his challengers.
Well, Simoni really is a man who can descend well in the wet, so maybe he'll close the gap a little bit here. But it looks as though Basso hasn't got a fault on his makeup this year, because he's shown us he can time trial, he's shown us he can climb, now he's showing us he can descend. Picture on our right is showing us Simoni, who looks to be in partnership with José Gutiérrez. Now they must be third and fourth on the road, but the gaps are big.
Gaps are big. Gutierrez is the man doing the majority of the pacemaking. Simoni, obviously not in great form yet in the Giro d'Italia, but you know, it's always in the Giro d'Italia the possibility of complete and utter turnarounds in the last week, and that may be what Gilberto Simoni is banking on, because we still have got some very difficult climbs in the last week of racing, and that could turn the overall classification completely upside down. Basso picking his way around these corners precariously, but Phil, whatever happens, even if he's not winning the stage, he's actually extending his lead over everybody else in this race.
Absolutely. Life up in the ski station is looking a bit miserable right now. They probably wish it was snowing rather than raining up here. Gutierrez turning out to be something of a sensation, just being overshadowed by the fantastic riding of Basso. Oh, at last our cameras, static ones at least, are going to give a little bit of kudos now to the man who's destroyed them all today. Leonardo Pipoli is heading up for a great win, especially for the team, Sonia Duval. This is a man who's 34 years of age, 35 in September this year, and he's got all the time in the world to take those corners a little bit more gently. He doesn't want to slip away on one of those bends. He's going to get the win here. Stage 13, lucky for some.
Well, certainly is. He's got the rhythm going. He's just out of the saddle, making sure that he gets this victory. He's been a man who we've seen for many, many years in the big stage races like the Vuelta a España ride well, and of course the Giro d'Italia. Here, given a free hand by his team leader, Gilberto Simoni, to try and go out and get the victory. He's a very lightly built rider. You know, he only weighs in at 51 kilos. That's not very much, is it?
It is not. Well, you know, back in 1999, it was less happy circumstances. He crashed out of the Vuelta with a broken collarbone, of the Giro, rather. And since then, he's finished 10th in this race, but now he's finally done for the first time what he's never done before. He's won a stage of the event to go with his stage victory in the Tour of Spain 2 years ago. But the man who's got everything to gain here and is racing right to the line, every second counts, Ivan Basso, is putting more time in the bank.
He's going to make some very big time gaps tonight, because the race is completely fractioned behind him. There are riders all over this descent and this run into town. 250 metres to go. What a miserable day it's been in the saddle for everybody. But I think when he looks at the overall classification tonight, Ivan Basso will have a little bit of a wry smile appear on the edge of his mouth there, because he knows now that he's starting to lay some pretty serious foundations in the Giro.
Well, it's going to mean 6 days in the pink jersey for him, and nearly a week has gone by since he took it, and he can afford to smile through the rain here, because that's a big day to tick off. Bad weather, come through it in second place, all of the race favourites behind him, and not behind him by 10 seconds, but I think behind him by minutes today. This is the lie for third place. José Gutiérrez and Simoni. I don't think Simoni will challenge him. They'll finish together in the same time. And of course, the commentator's always wrong, because Simoni is having a go at him.
Yep, he's thinking about the time bonuses. It's all going to be very important at the end of 3 weeks of racing. And Gutiérrez says, mate, you've just sat on me, so I am going to have the third place finish. Thank you very much, Simoni. You can stay fourth.
Justice will out, you see, and this is the race now for fifth place, and this is Scarponi here at the back of the group. Certainly the leaky gas ride will be Pellizzotti, another good mountain finish for him.
Well, the Frenchman in there is Jean Gadret, and I have to say I've never actually heard of him before. He's a young French rider from AG2R, but in fact he's riding exceptionally well here to get himself in so high in a mountain stage.
The team's riding very well. Vakus, remembers, won the stage for AG2R. Pellizzotti's now got the head of the furs here, being challenged by the Liberty Seguros Vert team, and that's Michele Scarponi. And Scarponi looks like he's going to finish it off. If he does, he'll get the fifth place across the line. And Gadret just happy to finish with the boys, I think. But we're talking huge time gaps. Look at the clock there. It's over 2 minutes now since the winner finished. And Basso, 44 seconds, and you take off that time there for Basso's gains today.
Well, Gadret there getting himself a nice place, seventh for him. And in fact, that's Perez coming in. That was the man that we couldn't recognize in the orange raincoat.
Julio Perez, yeah.
Former winner of the King of the Mountains classification. And everybody now filling in, coming in dribs and drabs. This is going to be Damiano Cunego and Salvadelli.
Still finding the legs to finish it off in the sprint from Savadelli. But time gaps, they've lost about a minute 55 to Ivan Basso. That is simply enormous today.
Well, there's going to be a big change, not for Leonardo Pipoli, because he will win the stage 44 seconds ahead of Basso. Gutiérrez and Simoni, I think, took some serious risks on the descent to reduce the gap. And you can see this young man has got himself what he's been dreaming of since he turned professional, a mountain victory in the Giro d'Italia.
Any victory in the Giro d'Italia, it's his first ever. And so he's up on the podium, and a good result for Sonia Duval as well. Oh, he looks rather shocked by those kisses. On to the Classement Generale, and Basso leading now by 3 minutes 27, over 5 minutes to Paolo Savadelli, who's got himself into third. Those gaps are simply enormous now, and no wonder he can afford to smile here, because as I keep telling you, the journey through the High Dolomites still lies ahead, and he's got lots of time now in the bank.
Well, Paolo Bettini now rightfully putting on the Cicalemina jersey, and he is a man who's got 86 points to Paolo Salvadelli, 79. Ivan Basso up there in third place. But once we get to the flatter stages, I think Bettini now, Phil, is going to start to increase his lead in that competition, because he is much more able to get himself points.
Eight days to go, a fly past, and they are not Italian aircraft, because I think they're from Switzerland, because that's where we're going today now, as they blow out the Italian flag colours, because this race making an incursion now into Switzerland, and they do it by climbing over the San Bernardo Pass. But this race now down to just under 170 riders left in.
Two big mountain passes on the route this afternoon. The riders moving away from Aosta this morning, heading up to the summit of the San Bernard, descending into Switzerland, going through the town of Sion. But then it's all the very nasty climb at the end, the Passo Sempione, before descending down back into Italy for the finish in Domodossola.
And not surprisingly, it's been a day of getting the group away that doesn't really matter. Fortunato Baleon is having his best tour of Italy, I can remember. He's a very good climber.
Check out his heart rate, though. Look at that. He's working now at 97%, tickling the maximum heart rate that he can possibly come in with. This man, I remember a couple of years ago, was the winner of the King of the Mountains classification in the Tour de Langkawi in Malaysia. And he's a man who, over the years, has been very aggressive in the Giro d'Italia. Sits up, looks over his shoulder, waiting to see if the other guys who were in the breakaway with him are going to rejoin him.
They're just behind him. In fact, Sandy Cassari's in the breakaway. Paolo Tirolongo, Zampieri, Steph Schumacher. There's the full list for you. Sandy Cassari, in fact, was the erstwhile leader in the King of the Mountains competition. But in all honesty, up until today, and it might be changing now because of those points by Baleani, but Basso himself has been the leader of the King of the Mountains since he got the race lead. And he's got a double header going there. This is the breakaway now. Frankly, so far ahead, the winner's going to come from this group.
Well, the last time check we got was 9.5 minutes back to the main field. And as you say, Phil, none of these riders in this leading group are at all dangerous in the overall classification. And I have a feeling that maybe the guys will have a little bit of a day off. A man to watch out for towards the end there is Ivan Parra, rides for Cofidis. He's a man that could ride away when we come to the Passo Sempione.
Well, we're going to see what's going to happen now, because this little group has got everything to race for. Panaria got a couple of men in this breakaway, and Baleoni's had a good day out. I think he's done enough to capture the King of the Mountains competition. It's a green jersey, by the way, and we don't see it too often so far in this tour. Caught a glimpse of it about a week ago, I think. And this breakaway, nobody affecting Basso, who's having something of a day off here as he prepares for the final week of battle.
In fact, that's the man I was just mentioning before. This is Ivan Parra, was a revelation last year in the Giro d'Italia, and he's decided this is a good move. Sandy Cassar, the French hope for the future, has decided he too is trying to get himself a little bit of glory on a stage like this.
There's another look at the attack, and that's the way to attack. Three or four men down, swing to the right of the road. Not worry about anybody, give it your best shot. But Cassar was paying attention there, and he's gone straight after him.
Well, Parra won two stages in the mountains in the Giro last year when he was riding for Sella Italia, and that's why they picked him up, the team Cofidis. 8.5 minutes the advantage between the Gruppo di Testa and the Gruppo di Maglia Rosa, who on the right-hand side really don't seem to be panicking too much. Looks like Bobby Julek going through there. There's the pink jersey a little bit further back of Ivan Basso, with, I have to say, a very sensible lead in this race. I'm not really sure, Phil, can anybody challenge him? It's really becoming a race for him to lose.
Now, this has very definitely been a day of transition for Ivan Basso. There is nobody in that front group. There are 11 riders up front affecting the situation at all. So the 9 minutes won't mean a thing, but the winner will, of course, not agree with those comments. Because everybody wants to win a stage. And now we've been through Switzerland, we're back in Italy, and we're heading up towards the finish. Sandy Cassar in the hot seat at the front as he looks around to see who's going to make the next move.
Well, the next move will surely not come until we start the ascent of the Passo Sempione, a very difficult climb which will take the riders away from Switzerland and drop down into the finish line in Italy.
So we're looking at the riders here all together, thinking now, who's going to start the sprint that might? 6 kilometres to go to the finish. And, well, numerically, of course, one or two riders do have a couple of teammates here. Ico Flores, he's not going to do much in the sprint, I don't think. He'd have liked a hilltop finish. Fonac have got Steve Zampieri. Johann Schopp is also here. And Panaria have a couple of riders here in Fortunato Baleoni, who's been very active, and he has got the lead in the King of the Mountains, and also Luis Laverde. So there's two riders here. Case de Pon has one, Francisco Perez, and Lamprey has one in Paolo Tirolongo, who's also a good climber.
Oh, there's a little move. Somebody's going through the tunnel there. I think. I'm very surprised that it didn't split up a lot more on the Sempione. But as you can see, I'm just trying to look down there and see who's the man. Again, it's Parra trying to make the move there from Cofidis. Again, covered there by the man in the white jersey, Sandy Cassar, pulling it all back together. These riders are all now very much of a similar ability, and it's a question of who's got the chance to try and surprise someone with a late move.
Well, Cassar held the green jersey for 3 days during the transition from Belgium across to Italy, but he soon lost out on that when Basso took control. Now today, Basso's lost his lead in the King of the Mountains to Baleoni. And is that Baleoni who's gone? Is it Laverde? It's one or the other.
Well, it was one of the riders. It looked like the Euskaltel rider who was in that group.
Oh, well, in which case it's Ico Flores, the one man I said couldn't win. Oh, thank heaven for that.
Baleoni's just sitting at the back of the group there, just ahead of Parra. Parra's the man just to go into the back of the group. Now the move coming here from Case de Pagna.
Well, this is going to be a move here, and this will be from Francisco Perez Sanchez, and, well, he's advertised it well enough, but he's gone.
A strong attack there, very powerful indeed, and there's somebody coming across the gap, and I think that's Laverde going after him. And there you can see that this is always the difficult part at the end of a long breakaway like this. Everybody's just starting to feel a little bit more tired and wondering whether or not they're responsible for making the effort to pull it all back together.
Yeah, just who is there left to chase? You can see there's two Fonac riders here, Zampieri and Schopp, and they don't look as though they've got the legs to do much about this.
Well, this is Laverde,
yes,
but he
is.
Hasn't quite got onto the wheel there of Perez.
No.
He's really so. Perez has made a very strong move.
But these guys are waiting too long. That was Rafael Iliano there, the Sella Italia rider in the light blue-white colours. He's trying to do something about it. He's done well in this competition in the hotspot sprint series into Giro in the past.
Look at the gear that Laverde is using there. He's just trying to get onto the wheel of the man in front of him, Perez. And Perez, I think he's just done it now. He have a chance to get a little bit of a breather. We're inside of about 4.5 kilometres to go. So Luis Laverde has made the junction. Let's have a look back here. Well, it's not much of a gap.
It's a bit dangerous when you sling off your bottle. If you meant to sling it off like that into the path of the riders behind. This is the Cofidis rider just in the rear of the race.
That's Parra.
He's hanging on a bit now, but these two have got together, but they're not exactly pulling away, are they?
Well, no, Perez there on the front is doing the majority and the bulk of the move, and you can see the gap is not great. It's around about 40, 45 metres. Theoretically, they should get pulled back into the fold. And it's Laverde who's not doing any work at all there. I think he must have made the big effort to get across the gap.
Nice crowd down in the basement in the town. Now it's going to get a little bit tougher as the riders head up towards the finish here. And two riders clear. Francisco Perez of Case de Pan and Luis Laverde of Penaria. And Laverde just checking over his shoulder there while Perez does all of the work. Perez, the long, lanky rider, seems to be a lot of power, and there's nobody really closing that gap. If anything, that gap has opened slightly, and there's not a lot of people here behind willing to do the work. The Gelsteiner rider down there is Stefan Schumacher, who can pack a sprint finish.
Well, it's up to him, Phil, to make the effort to try and pull it all back together, because if it is a large group together coming into the finishing straight, I reckon Stefan Schumacher, already a stage winner in the Giro, has got a chance to get himself the win. Laverde now has seen the gap and decided, I'm going to work with Perez and try and consolidate, and they are doing. It's now out to around about 100 metres.
Yes, Schumacher won stage three and was rewarded with the pink jersey. There's no way that can happen today, but he can win the stage if he nails back these leaders here.
Well, that was Iliano just trying to make the effort there, just coming off the front. Sandy Cassar also, but this, when you see how much time it takes to get across the gap, is a good gap for these two leaders. That's Perez on the front, Case de Pana, followed by Laverde. Laverde not hanging about now, deciding to come forward and help set the pacemaking.
Well, I really never thought this was going to work. It's almost a slow-motion breakaway. They've just put these boys on the limit, and I think they are pulling away in sight of the finish virtually here. That's a much bigger gap now.
Well, I'm not sure if these two riders do survive. Who I'm going to put my money on for the sprint, I would have to say, I think the Case de Pana rider, who seems to be very strong indeed. I don't know a whole lot about Laverde, apart from the fact that looking at his build here, he must be an exceptionally good climber.
Well, Perez is perhaps getting a little bit excited here. He's doing the lion's share of the work. Laverde, if you go on the form book, has never won a race since 2003 when he won the fourth stage of a race in Italy, the Settimana Lombardi. And he's sitting there behind and doesn't seem, he's either unwilling or unable to help here.
Well, Perez, in fact, the man on the front in the dark black jersey of Case de Pana, did have a win in the early part of the season. He won the Grand Prix Almeria in February, but that was an awful long time ago. They're now getting into the outskirts of time. There's a time gap, 8 seconds between the two leaders and the Inseguitori, the chasers. And now is the time when it starts to get just that little bit more tactical. Perez, quite happy to keep the pressure on, knows that they need to keep working together. Laverde only going through when the Spanish rider forces him to go to the front and help share the pacemaking.
That's what he should be doing, getting the rider to come and work with him, because once you see the finish, riders change their mentality, and all of the energy they thought they didn't have, they find. 1.8 kilometres to go, just over a mile and a bit to the finishing line here now. The gap is only 8 seconds, and it's not over yet. Because
it's less than 8 seconds.
I think you're probably five or six.
That's
now.
That's Iliano.
But Iliano's on his own. He's got nothing left. He's got to do something. That's Tirolongo just behind him. He's the Lamprey rider here.
That is not 8 seconds anymore. I would say that's down to 4 or 5 seconds. These riders, every time they go around a corner now, will be looking to see if they can see the red kite, hoping that they're coming in. There's a big crowd out to see this stage.
Looking at this, it's a good job it wasn't a bunch sprint as they come around this corner. The road seems to narrow out quite a well. Looking down again from the top.
Baliani doing a good job there, coming to the front.
Good.
He's trying to back it all off. Look at his heart rate, 94%. He's trying to slow it down around these corners. He thinks his teammate can come up with the win. Well, even if they stay clear, the worst he can do is second place.
Well, they're lining up for the finish here. 1,300 metres to go. Look at that. They're around the back bend here now. These two can't afford to mess about. as they look at each other and ride side by side. They're gambling now, very much so, Laverde and Perez. This is Schumacher right on the front now. And Baliani still trying to break up the chase, which is a good team tactic.
There's Steve Lampieri in there as well for Team Phonak. Now this is the moment when Laverde is starting to play a little tactical game. There is the ultimo kilometro, last kilometre, and is still holding on to about 5 or 6 seconds advantage.
Now every pedal brings them closer to the line. As they look over the shoulder, they're gambling here big time. And it looks as though Perez has manoeuvred at the last minute. Laverde into first place, and he's gone. Perez has used that to jump. Now he's jumped at about 900 metres, maybe 800 to the line. He's gambling on an awful long sprint, and I think that's a mistake. He's going to pull these two away from the chasers.
Oh, he has done.
Yeah, but he's going to hand the race back now to Luis Felipe Laverde for sure.
Laverde was locked in there into the slipstream of the Spanish rider, Francisco Perez. They've got the gap now. I don't think they're going to get caught because there's no reaction coming in that group behind, which is being paced by Sandy Cassar. 350 metres to go. Cassar on the front of the group. Steve Zampieri in second place. Now, look how well positioned Laverde is here.
Well, I mean, Perez really gave this one away. He tried too soon out, and then there's no way Laverde was going to come off his wheel until the right moment. An easy win in the end, and a big win for Laverde, and a great day out for Panaria. They win the stage, and they get the leader in the King of the Mountains with Baliani, who's in the centre of this group.
It was
Tirolongo, Schumacher with the first two there. Yeah.
And bear in mind, Phil, that Team Panaria is a wild card selection, not a member of the Pro Tour. They came in as one of the last teams, along with Celitalia, and they've got something to take home as well.
Well, Celitalia get in because they're part of the sponsorship of the Giro d'Italia, so it's really an invitation which can be always foreseen. But Panaria have to fight for their way in. Here's the sprint now. They get a stage win in Luis Laverde.
Really timed it to perfection. I really expected that Perez was the stronger rider of the two, but making that effort at 900 metres to go, he didn't have anything left to make a second effort. And the main field now in the outskirts of town. This looks like Charlie Wergelius working for the team and Danilo De Luca, but almost 6.5 minutes since the breakaway came in.
Well, as I said earlier, there's no reason to worry about this because this field has had something of a day off today before the battle resumes again. They're going to be just over 7 minutes behind. And what's the betting that Paolo Bettini might try and stretch his legs and just nip a couple of points for that Ciclamino points leader's jersey? We've only seen one jersey change today. We're not going to see a change in the points. Jens Voigt again driving at the front of the field, as he always seems to do, always mindful of where the pink jersey is, his race leader, and keeping him safe.
Well, you're right about one thing. Paolo Bettini was right up there in the top six or seven. There is Danilo De Luca right on the wheel of the pink jersey of Ivan Basso. But I think we could well see there is Bettini up into about third position there. And again, Milram making the lead out. I'm really not sure why.
No, we've never worked that one out the whole tour since we lost Alessandro Bertacchi. But here comes Bettini now. This will be the sprint coming up for 12th place. So there are points available. He makes it pretty easy. And I don't know who was placed there, but I think it's probably Sven Kraus, the Gerolsteiner rider.
Well, it's a Gerolsteiner at the front and a Gerolsteiner at the back here. But they did have Stefan Schumacher in the breakaway. And again, Laverde confirmed here as the winner ahead of Perez. Tirolongo very upset to get third place, and Schumacher riding sensibly in the group and getting fourth, with Iliano and Baliani making up the top six.
Official time gap, 7 minutes and 44 seconds back to Basso's group. So time gains for a few riders today, but none of them looking long term to the win of this tour. So it was a safe day of racing for Ivan Basso, and the big gaps remain. Look at that. 7.5 to Belli in fourth. 8 minutes to Simoni, who's a double winner of this race. Sandy Cassar, who was in the break, he gets up into sixth place now and is having a very good race. They're all smiles.
Ivan Basso looking very happy now with the way this race is unfolding. He really now doesn't have to go out onto the attack anymore. From now till the finish, he can play a defensive game. And this is the change in the King of the Mountains classification. The popular Fortunato Baliani gets himself the lead by a single point, but that's enough.
Yes, and that is enough. He stays in green for tomorrow's stage, and he'll be happy enough with that. Great day out for Panaria. Per la nuova maglia verde, Fortunato! And one of his best tours for sure. Well, this stage 15 would have suited the sprinters, Pataki and McCue. Neither are now in the Giro d'Italia. This is dead flat all the way to Brescia.
Well, I think this has got to be one of the flattest stages of the Giro, as you can see, and it's definitely going to be a stage for the sprinters. The riders, they could take a right-hand turn halfway through this afternoon stage and get themselves down into Milano, but sadly for them, the race in the last week has got to rear up into the Dolomiti.
And not surprisingly, the peloton heading into town as a massed group here today, as we're running towards the big mountainous days of this year's Giro d'Italia, and Basso carrying all of the minutes he wants towards the finish in Milan. There's the long line. It's a sprinter's delight. There aren't that many fast sprinters in. Maybe a day for Olaf Pollock today.
5 kilometres to go. I'm just trying to see which team is on the front doing the majority of the pacemaking. It looks as if there are a few pink jerseys of T-Mobile on the front end of the main field. And right up there as well, we've got the big Belgian there, the Belgian national champion.
Only non-starter today, by the way, bringing the field down to about 167. Axel Merckx, they're not starting for the Phonak team. This looks like Serge Bagge, is it, on the front at the moment? Yes, it is. First time we've seen him.
First time we've seen the Belgian national champion. Just looking down to see who is it up and around. There, number 101, the leader of Gerald Steiner, Robert Forster. He's a man who can turn out a good sprint sometimes as well. You've got T-Mobile in second and third position. They're thinking about Pollack. Then maybe Ongarato is going to be the man. Look at Milram. This is sadly, Phil.
It's almost as if they're just training. I don't know what they're doing.
Well,
or they're being paid, which is totally illegal by another team to lead out riders.
Well, the man who is always on the end of the train just happens to be Paolo Bettini. And it's a team which really in the Giro has got nothing at all to look for, because they lost their man Alessandro Pataki before the race even got down into the country of Italy. He never even left Belgium.
Well, on the face, the way they're working here, as you look at the heart rates at 90% of one of the riders there, Bagge will be on this pacemaking for Paolo Bettini for sure, because he's the leader in points. And the T-Mobile riders, they're going to be working for Olaf Pollock. And so they're the two riders I think we should concentrate on today.
Well, moving up there as well, I just caught a quick glimpse of Martin Elmiger, the Swiss national champion, over to the right-hand side in the red jersey with the white cross on it. Very dangerous. There's Bettini looking comfortable, just sitting on the long line of these riders from Milram. Maybe they're practicing for Eric Zabel for the Tour de France.
Huge efforts now being made. We haven't seen anything, by the way, of Jan Ulrich since he gave us that big surprise result in the time trial. He's gone back into his...
anonymity?
Yes, that's the word. I can never say that word. As we're now looking here again at Milram, and it looks as though T-Mobile are taking much more control now.
Well, T-Mobile will be looking for the win. Just looking over there, there's a couple of riders moving up to the front from Davita Monlotto. They won't be looking after their man Robbie McEwen, because McEwen comfortably now at home in Belgium.
Surprisingly, though, we haven't lost a lot of riders this year. Just over 20 riders retired, which is not a big number at this stage of a major tour. There's Bettini sitting right behind the Milram boys again. Well, you're not allowed to use other teammates officially to help pace you to the line, but it's not easy to prove. And I'm wondering if the team is showing a better allegiance than they might to Paolo Bettini.
Well, could be the case, because Bettini always seems to be the man to get to the end of that line of riders. Let's not forget, after all, they're nearly all Italians, although Milram is pretty much a German team. Well, you did say you hadn't seen Ulrich. Well, there he is riding at the front, and this is a big turn of speed. He may well also be thinking about trying to lead out his man Olaf Pollack. You know, in the early part of his career, Jan Ulrich was not averse to taking a bunch sprint out himself.
Absolutely. The man can actually do very, very well in bunch sprinting, and he is a very strong lead-out man. He's searching for form, don't forget, and this is a good dress rehearsal for the upcoming Tour de France. There's the big man, Jan Ulrich, suddenly lifted the tempo a little bit as those legs start to pound the pedals yet again.
Well, he does look a little bit heavy, though, and I think he does need to lose a few pounds. He probably has to cut out the pasta plate when he goes to dinner in the evenings, because I don't think yet he's fighting weight for the Tour de France. Still, Milram pretty much in control at the front of the peloton.
4 Milram riders have gone round there. The last of them was Alberto Ongarato, and just behind Ongarato was indeed Paolo Bettini, as they now are lining up for the finish. No sign of anybody now from T-Mobile, since the man himself swung off the front. There's Bettini. with his ever-present golden helmet.
Simoni cricket. And a man who was absolutely superb in the Athens Olympic Games. He went out on a breakaway with two laps to go there when everybody was expecting his move to come on the final lap. A big risk he took there, but he came up with a victory. And I think a very good Olympic champion, Paolo Bettini, and a kind of man who can always come up with the win.
Now, Milram has swung out of it here now, and we've got Française de Jeu, perhaps for Carlos de Cruz to try and pull something special. That's de Cruz on second wheel here, and that's a nice position to find yourself in as you head under the kilometre kite. And it will be a big surprise if Carlos beat these boys.
Well, he's a little bit too far to the front too early for me with a kilometre to go. You need to be in about sixth or seventh position. There's a few guys queuing up now onto the wheel there of Paolo Bettini. Olaf Polak was one of those riders. He's the T-Mobile rider in about seventh.
And again, Milram have got their riders to the front. There are three of them left. They're in a perfect position here, you know, these three riders. They've done it time and time again and have not delivered their last man to the line. That's Pollock now, also tucked in right on the wheel of Paolo Bettini. He's just one back from Paolo Bettini. Boxed in a little bit there. Bit of a box happening because that's Robert Foster of Gerolsteiner. Now, can anybody get out of this mess? Because Bettini looks blocked in as they make the run for the line. Now, this is Foster, I think, who's opened up the sprint. And Pollock is coming on the left of our picture. And right through the middle is Paolo Bettini, shoulder to shoulder with Olaf Pollock. And on the line, it looks as though this time Paolo Bettini has got the win.
Well, it was very close indeed between him and Olaf Pollock, but I think this time he's put his hands up correctly. He really believes he's got the win this time. I'd like to see how close it was from a different angle, because Pollock looked to be in complete control. This is the point when Paolo Bettini looks like he's got the race lost. The acceleration coming from Forster. Look at Pollack on the right-hand side, just leaning. These guys have absolutely no fear at all. Bettini's got the advantage here. Pollack clawing his way up alongside, but it's going to be the last lunge for the line that decides it. Still Bettini in front. Oh, he's definitely got it this time.
Poor old Olaf, because it's certainly his third second place of the tour. It might even be his fourth, but he still can't find the legs just to give him that win. Look how short he is this time.
Well, he's just a little bit short on this occasion, but let's not forget he got himself two stage wins in the Amgen Tour of California at the start of the year. Bettini, Pollack, Forster, and Henk Vogels was up there for fourth place.
Well done, Henk. Without his team leader, of course, McEwen, he's trying to deliver for himself. There's the official margin. Here's Il Grillo, the cricket. He's jumped to victory this time, and that's a big win for him. Former champion of Italy, showing the flashes on his sleeves. And a good win for Quickstep, that. Shoulder to shoulder with his main sprinter now. This is giving him a huge lead in the points competition. We might try and give you an update on that. But first of all, the overall classification. No time changes here at all. Salvadelli, Belli, Simoni, fifth. Cazar in sixth. All looking rather good for Ivan Basso now as we go into the last few days of the Giro d'Italia, and they are the hardest. But he's building every day his time gaps. There's the situation in the points race for the Ciclamino. That's a huge lead, but it's not an unassailable one. And not surprisingly, it's Olaf Pollock with his continuing run of second places that gives him yet one more second place in the points competition. And so, after 2.5 weeks, the riders are now in sight of the Dolomites. This is a tough stage, this one, as they also finish at the top of a mountain.
Very difficult stage, a big incursion into the Dolomites for the riders on today's stage. They go over the Passo Maniva halfway through the stage, the Passo Ampola, but when they get down to the end after circumnavigating the Lago di Garda, they've got the very difficult ascent to the famous climb of the Monte Bondone, climbing up to 1,650 metres.
And that's where we join the action, and one man not coming out to play today, stage 7 winner Rick Verbrugge, didn't start this morning. And there is Basso right at the head of this very select group. The day has been animated by one rider who's since been caught, Colombia's Miguel Rubiano. He got away very early on, but he was caught 21 kilometres from the finish. And this is the climb up to the finish now.
Well, this looks like Maurizio Ardila was having a hard time at the back. This looks like Leonardo Pipoli on the front, Carlos Sastre in second position. Now, look at the speed these guys are hitting this climb. They're trying to create serious damage already in the early kilometres of the climb.
Well, this is going to crumple some legs on the hill like this if they're going to ride it up. And this Danilo De Luca here, Jamaican flag on the right of the road there. They haven't got too many top internationals in that country, as Danilo De Luca sits on the back, but he's beginning to look as though he might be put under some sort of pressure here.
Well, he's a man who I thought was going to finish high up in the overall classification. I think just a couple of places in front of him as well is Paolo Savardelli. There he is in the blue jersey, leader of the combine classification. Just in front of him, Juan Manuel Garate. And this is Leonardo Pipoli. Now, is he riding for himself here this afternoon, or is he trying to do something for Gilberto Simoni?
Pipoli's having a great Giro, but he's having a great Giro despite the fact he seems to be concentrating on helping Simoni. That's what he's doing now. He's on the shoulder of Simoni. These boys are looking after Damiano Cunego.
Now, that's not a good sign. This is Bruce Egin on the front looking over his shoulder to see where Cunego is. A lot of riders caught out by this acceleration. There's Garate, the blue jersey on the shoulders there, of course, of Paolo Salvadelli. This is the leading group.
Yes, and just look who's setting the pace now. It's our old friend Carlos Sastre, who's trying to look after yet again Ivan Basso. It looks to me, horribly so, that they're setting up Basso here to shoot to the finish. Simone's in the right position, locked onto his wheel. Gutierrez is there. These are the men now. Cunego has already said in the press publicly he can't win this tour. He can only hope that he has a good ride. And well, I think that's gone too. He's not here.
Well, Cunego's got age on his side. And let's not forget he was very seriously ill last year with mononucleosis or glandular fever, if you like. And he's fighting his way back into this sport. And I think in the years to come, he will be a serious challenger to win the Giro d'Italia. But there's a lot of riders being put under pressure. This is Emmanuel Seller with the orange jersey on here. We've seen him so many times. And Giampaolo Caruso, as you can see, Phil, is actually riding at 100% of his maximum ability here at only 17 kilometres now. That's Caruso just on the back of this group.
Well, Basso took the lead of this tour with a demonstrative display on stage 8. He's never lost control of it since, and he's looking back on big time gains. It must be a great feeling when you climb a mountain towards the finish. He's relying heavily yet again on Carlos Sastre, who is such a superb teammate. He's done it for him in the Tour de France and helped him up to a high finish there against Lance Armstrong. Now he's trying to do it here as well. He's going to make the pace up this climb until he physically can do it no more. And then, Paul, I expect to see Basso try once again to go alone.
Watch out for Julio Perez, though, because he's in the group and he's the kind of rider who will ride very carefully and try and get clear towards the finish. That's Caruso just logged on the back there. The other rider in there for AG2R is Jean Gadret again. So this young Frenchman, who I seriously don't know very much about, is actually riding fairly well in the mountains.
A bit of a find, I must confess. I don't think he's ever won a race, but he's certainly riding well today and all week.
Well, here's composition. Gadret, Perez, Lopez, Caruso, Gutierrez is in there. Victor Hugo Peña is in there as well. Gilberto Simoni riding very well. There's Caruso. Very happy to be in the league with the very top names in the Giro d'Italia. Paolo Salvadelli suffering on the mountains. And the difficult thing for Paolo Salvadelli is the way he won his Giro last year was he suffered on the uphills, but he pulled himself back into the race on the descents. Emmanuel Seller now.
And Seller, having been discovered in the Giro a couple of years ago, is now very much a part of it. He's recovered from that rather nasty tumble he had a few days ago.
I think he's going to get himself back into this group. He seems to be riding fairly well. Ooh. Also coming up as well.
Pellizzotti.
Pellizzotti. And this is Victor Hugo Peña, who was supposedly in that group, but he must be riding himself back into contention. A man who was aware of the yellow jersey in the Tour de France when he was a member of the US Postal Service team of Lance Armstrong.
Just look at Carlos Sastre here. He's only ever won 4 races in his career, yet this man is worth every penny they pay him. He's so unselfish, he's always riding, and yet he's very close to being a team leader himself. But Basso, just that little bit of an edge, I think, is the better of the two riders. And Sastre winning the Classica Primavera, the Spring Classic in Italy back in April. That's his only win of the year.
Well, he finished 3rd overall in the Tour of Spain last year, but he's a great ally here. I think every one of the other 8 riders on Team CSC came to this race thinking that they were going to dedicate this 3 weeks to one man. And Carlos Sastre is certainly dedicating today, while further down the slopes, it's Chechu Rubiera who's coming forward now for Discovery to look after Paolo Salvadelli to try and make sure he limits the losses and keeps himself in the top 5.
Well, this is a serious split now. Simone's gone, and so too has Basso, the big ask, and so too has Gutierrez. and the others are now losing time. There could be a minor reshuffle amongst the places tonight.
Well, actually, Kunigo Salvadelli Group is said to be recovering a bit. The official time gap is only 18 seconds, but it appeared to be a lot more than that to me. This is Sellep. This is Victor Hugo Peña. Let's have a look back. That's the group of Kunigo, definitely.
Well, this is Salvadelli.
Yep, so they're not far behind. They're looking at about 18 seconds. So Paolo Salvadelli, with a sensible first few kilometres, could be coming back up to this group with the heads of state.
Well, as so often happens, the fast acceleration at the start hurts people, and then they settle into the rhythm and steadily climb back into the action. They need to measure their effort, really. There's Pelizzotti here, and this is Sella.
And Victor Hugo Peña was the other rider. Let's just have a look. I think they're only about 7 or 8 seconds from the group of Ivan Basso. There's the third group on the road over to the right-hand side. Chechu, Rubiera, Salvadelli, Garate. And just going off the back of the group, in fact, Kunigo is a man suffering there because he can't stick with the pacemaking set by Chechu, Rubiera.
2, 4, 6, 8, approximately 11 riders in this group here. And Basso is watching his rivals slip away. But here comes the cavalry back here. De Luca, Juan Manuel Garate.
Another man
there. Number one, Salvadelli.
We never see him in the Giro, but he's always there. Andrea Noe was also in this group. He's a man who's finished in the top 10 in the Giro, and we hardly ever see him attack, but he's always in the top 10 on the crucial stages.
He has got a tremendous reputation. He's had he's finished fourth twice in the Giro d'Italia. He's finished sixth once. And I think throughout those three Giros, we mentioned his name perhaps once. He just has a habit of being so consistent without being seen.
He could be put down as being the ghost rider, never visible but always there. That's Kunigo. Kunigo having a spot of bother here this afternoon. He hasn't been able to stick with Paolo Salvadelli, and he could be going through a bad day. You know, in a grand tour like this, everybody has a bad day one day or another. But this man doesn't seem to have any bad days in the mountains, Leonardo Pipoli.
There's the composition of this select group that's trying to get back on terms. Kunigo's in the group on the far right. And this is a big catch now for the leaders, and Simoni is also improving his overall position, a man for the podium yet again. As he continues.
These are the climbers now going forward. Pipoli followed there by Julio Perez, and you can see the gap starting to appear. Carlos Sastre having a hard time staying on the wheel, but slowly dragging his man up there, Ivan Basso in fifth position. Right behind him is José Enrique Gutiérrez, and the man who seemed to be suffering from the acceleration of his own teammate was Gilberto Simoni. Excuse me, says Carlos Sastre, I'm coming by. I am the pilot fish for the top man, and I'm going to control the pacemaking here. And Simoni has come back.
Is hurting himself, Sastre, but he doesn't matter. He's still holding this race. He knows with every pedal rev, Basso's lead cannot possibly be endangered. That looks like Gadre down there, who's just hanging on to the tail and riding a brilliant race now because there's only seven of them left.
Well, to me, he is a major revelation, this young man, Jean Gadre, and the French are going to be very happy about his performances in the mountains. Damiano Kunigo suffering a fraction, but this is also a psychological moment for Carlos Sastre. He's gone to the front to dictate the pace with his team leader sitting on his wheel there, and psychologically, that makes everybody else think this man, Ivan Basso, for the moment is untouchable because he's got a strong ally alongside him. Caruso also suffering now.
Yes, but he's having a good tour as well and climbing very, very well.
Yep, but he's not able to stick with that pace. This is a little bit further down. Chechu Rubiera, the man who for many years was the right lieutenant of Lance Armstrong in the Tour de France, now assuming the same role for Paolo Salvadelli.
Very select little group, this one. And sitting at the back here is Patrice Algon, is the rider there for Crédit Agricole in the green. That's the next group on the road. This guy's never looked in trouble. He's never looked as though he's been under pressure yet.
Not under pressure there. Sitting behind him is Gutierrez, followed by Pipoli. Simoni not looking too bad now this afternoon. I think he's got his climbing legs on him, and he needs to do that because the next few stages are going to be very difficult here in the Giro. Kunigo talking with the teammates. The teammates will come alongside him, have a little bit of a chat, try and encourage him. Don't panic. Just keep your own rhythm. Don't go into the red zone, because if you pop on a climb like this, you find yourself losing 3, 4 or 5 minutes.
It looks as though that's Ruggiano down there, who does appear to have popped.
Big time differences again being made here. As we look back down the road, there's a lot of riders have slipped off the pace here this afternoon. And that would...
Well, the bad news is this climb hasn't really started yet.
Yeah, that was Danilo De Luca as well. Just down at the bottom left-hand quadrant there is Cecchi Rubiera and Paolo Salvadelli. Right-hand side is Damiano Cunego. He's got Bruchegin to look after him. But the top left-hand corner, we're just having a quick look here at Leonardo Pipoli. Now, this is a little bit of a move. They're trying to set something up for Gilberto Simoni.
Well, this is interesting. Pipoli's obviously said, Simoni, if you're feeling better, let's go and see if we can affect Ivan Basso.
And he's got the gap.
Basso's had to take over the running here. And what they've done is get rid of Sastre and his pacemaking. And now it's going to become mano a mano here because Pipoli also has had to move over. And Basso, as smooth as you like, has just pedalled through and straight up to Gilberto Simoni.
Right onto the wheel. Gutiérrez has also seen the move there. He's up into third place. Pipoli recovered a little bit. He would have been taken by surprise, I think, by that acceleration of everybody else. But this is not the Gilberto Simoni of last year and the year before, is it? A couple of years ago, if he'd made a move like that, nobody would have been able to match it. And now it's being matched very easily. And look at the smooth pedalling action of Ivan Basso.
Yeah, but he's got the confidence, Basso, to go straight to the front, not wait to see if his rivals can hit him
again. Oh, he's cracked Gutiérrez, and that's important.
I'm surprised Gutiérrez is still high up overall because he's such a big guy for the mountains. But here we go, Simoni now. He's going to have to work here with Ivan Basso or the other way around, whichever the case may be.
Well, Simoni's obviously having a good day because he asked his teammate Leonardo Pipoli to set the pace and try and blow this race apart. And a move like this today could move him a little bit higher in the overall classification. He's prepared to work with Ivan Basso. Basso doesn't have to worry too much about Gilberto Simoni. I don't think Simoni's form is good enough to distance himself between the overall leader, but what it could do is allow Basso and Simoni to move clear of everybody else in the race.
Well, Gutiérrez here in danger of slipping down a little bit now. Simoni is making time. And Pipoli is not going to help Gutiérrez at all on this climb. He's going to sit on him now because his man's gone clear and there's still a ways to go yet up this mountain. Round about 8 kilometres still to climb, I think.
Well, Gutiérrez and Pipoli are the two riders chasing at around about 10 seconds. Look at the concentration on the face there of Gilberto Simoni. But you can see now, I think he's having a little bit of a hard time staying with Basso, who's cruising around these corners. And look at Simoni's under pressure here, Phil. You see the way his body's bobbing around a bit. He's just trying to keep the pedals going to stay in contact. And Basso is increasing his cadence pretty dramatically here. I think he wants to pop Simoni off his wheel. He's not going to attack. He's actually going to try and crack him.
Well, he's in and out the saddle, trying to nail him back and hoping that this hill just gets a little bit of respite in it, because that's a super pedalling style by Ivan Basso. Back straight, sitting upright, getting plenty of oxygen into the lungs. This is further down. This will be Julio Perez, yeah.
Yep. He's a great climber in the past. He's a man who... I think they made a bit of a mistake with him tactically when they tried to encourage him to be an overall standings rider, and he's much better off at having the ability to fly free on individual stages. Well, he's a long way down in this Giro because he's 66th overall, almost 45 minutes in arrears.
Former king of the mountains of the Giro d'Italia. Two occasions, if memory serves me right, as we're now looking down the slopes here. This is hairpinning up to the dizzy heights. This is one of the legendary climbs in the Giro d'Italia, as we're now seeing the two leaders using this platform to gain more time over their rivals. And it's going to be a lot more time for Basso, who's putting this race out of sight of anybody. 7 kilometres to go. Further down the slopes, Gutiérrez under the police escort of Leonardo Pipoli. And in fact, he's trying to get rid of Pipoli.
Well, a little bit further up now, you can see Basso is getting out of the saddle. There's not much time gap between these riders because just looking back around the corner in front of Gutiérrez, I could see the yellow car, but Simoni now can't stay on the wheel of Basso. He's going to have his own teammate, I think, for company in a short while. There's the gap, 10 metres, 15, 20.
This is the start of it. Gilberto Simoni could not have been in a better position to attack Basso, and he couldn't do it. Basso kept his rhythm and obviously was very confident because he took up the pacemaking as soon as he got up to Simoni. Felt he could break him and has broken him. Now he's on free to fly now. Every pedal rev, more minutes in the bank are coming his way. This has been a real demonstration of leading a tour this year.
Well, it's a demonstration of the team as well, because let's not forget it was the team that set up the first few kilometres of this climb. It was then taken over by one of the members of the team, Carlos Sastre, who set a phenomenal tempo, decimating the group, putting riders like Paolo Salvadelli and Damiano Cunego into difficulty. But now he's got what he wanted. He's cracked Gilberto Simoni, a former two-time winner of this race. And shortly, I would think Simoni will get joined by Gutierrez and Pipoli, but there's 8 seconds the gap
already.
But it's about to stretch to a lot more than that, I think.
Well, Ivan Basso won at the top of the Passo Lanciano. He's now heading to the top of the Monte Bondone, and it looks like he might be winning again. He's not leaving much to the rest in this year's Giro d'Italia. 8 seconds and building. You can see by the way he's riding, looking straight ahead, making the effort, whereas Simoni is changing his position, looking down. He's not concentrating, hasn't got it now.
A little bit further down, we're looking here at Caruso. It's 8 seconds to Simoni, 20 seconds to Gutierrez Pipoli, and then a lot further back, there are all kinds of riders stretched out all over this mountain. Let's have a look at the distance there. We're looking at around about 200 metres already on the slopes of a climb like this. It's very hard to reverse. This man now, I think, Phil, is riding away with the Giro d'Italia. You know, we started in the beginning of the Giro saying we thought it was a tall order to try and win the Giro d'Italia and the Tour de France, but this man is actually riding away from the Giro so easily that I have a funny feeling he could still be a serious challenger when we go through to the Tour.
He's obviously got terrific form for this race, though, and you've got to hold it for another big Grand Tour. There's only a 3-week gap between the two races. Not an easy thing to do, but if he can do it, he's given himself the best chance. At least it looks now, barring accidents, he's going to get part one of the doubleheader in the bank here, because nobody's going to touch him. Everyone's tried, and he's literally ridden them off his wheel. Ivan Basso, who won the Criterium Internationale this year, by the way, and he also won the time trial stage in the Circuit de la Sarthe, which is only a small race, but he showed us then he was learning how to time trial.
It might be only a small race, but it was also a race that used to be used by a certain Lance Armstrong in his pre-Tour de France preparation on a number of occasions. A race where there's not a lot of pressure, but it gives you the chance to try out new material, new positions, new helmets to make sure everything is going to perfection. But what Gilberto Simoni is also doing here, Phil, although he's not able to stay with Ivan Basso, he's actually himself, I think, crawling up in the overall classification. He could see himself at the end of today climbing into a podium position.
It looks as though it's Pellizzotti there turning the screw a little bit. He's also suddenly riding very, very well. His overall position is not a fluke right now as he's riding through the Dolomites.
Nope.
It's him down there. This is the man up front. Can't see anybody up here now apart from himself. And they keep closing in on the back wheel. I expect to see a flat tyre, but fortunately that's not the case.
I think what they're trying to show is the size of the sprockets that he's got on that gear there, because they're trying to indicate just how steep this climb is. It's a savagely steep climb, and at certain points of this climb, it kicks into 24% the gradient. So these riders will be using gear ratios today. As we look here at Vladimir Belli, they'll be using gear ratios of around about a 38-tooth chainring on the inside with a 26-tooth chainring at the back as we go through 5Ks to go.
It's an awful long way to go. He made his move at around 6.5 over Simoni, and now he's been away for that kilometre or so as he continues the ascent, but 5 kilometres, 3 miles to the summit. These are the riders in third and fourth, and Pipoli still playing the faithful man. Sitting behind Gutierrez, won't help Gutierrez at all. Maybe he'll jump Gutierrez before the finish. Here's Simoni at 5 kilometres. The gap has opened. It's just over half a minute between the two now.
But what's probably more important now for Gilberto Simoni is not to panic. He knows he's not going to get himself the stage victory because he will not pull himself back to Ivan Basso. But riding sensibly like this, ticking out a good rhythm, he will be pulling himself back into this race. He'll be getting time back on Gutierrez there, who's the man who started the day in second place overall. But he'll be stretching his advantage over riders like Paolo Salvadelli and Damiano Cunego. And I think he could be looking at third place tonight.
Oh, look at the way this man is going around these bends. He's accelerating around the corners. 33 seconds to Simoni, 49 to Gutierrez.
But where are Damiano Cunego and Paolo Salvadelli? That's maybe what is more important. That's Simoni going around the corner there, bottom left-hand corner. Gutierrez trying to keep himself up there in second place overall. A bit of a revelation, really, Gutierrez in the Giro d'Italia this year. He's got people just sitting on his wheel, and people I don't think will make a move, Phil, until we get to the last 200 metres. He wants to protect the position of his leader, Gilberto Simoni. But this man, with the retirement of Lance Armstrong, I think is going to be the man for the Grand Tours for the next couple of seasons. That's right. Make sure, even in a breakaway situation like this, that you keep yourself topped up with energy. That's why he's taking on board that very serious energy bar.
There's still a long way to go here. Words of wisdom from Bjarne Riis there, once the winner of the Tour de France, the only Danish rider to have done that. And now he's seeing his man run away with this year's Giro d'Italia. Yes, he's only won one stage of it, but the way he's gained time over his rivals so far has been very, very impressive. He's heading to his second stage win now. This is stage 16 of 21 stages of this year's Tour, as they head up towards the finish.
He just looks so comfortable. He's got a nice high cadence. That means he's got a good, comfortable gear in there, ticking it over. Looks to me to be doing about 90, 95 revolutions a minute. Not quite the high cadence of Lance Armstrong, but not very far away. Armstrong, when he retired from the sport after winning the Tour de France for the seventh time, did say that this man was going to be the heir to his throne. He had so much respect for Ivan Basso, and Ivan Basso now laying some serious foundations for a win in the Giro. Look at the power here of Gutiérrez, but he's under pressure, trying to make sure that he doesn't lose too much time to the man in front.
The frightening thing about this, you know, Paul, is that this is the first big day in the mountains. We've got four more days now, all brutally hard. This isn't the hardest day either, before we start the last stage into Milan. And if he's doing this on day one of what is now nearly a week in the mountains, not quite, what is he going to do? He's going to set himself up to win this race by the biggest margin for years.
Well, it's setting itself to be that way already. There's some huge gaps in the overall standings. He doesn't really seem to be under an awful amount of pressure. It looks as if he's just digging a little bit deeper into the reserves there, but I don't think he's destroying his chances of riding well in July either by really having to pull himself inside out. This man is doing that, pulling himself inside out, Gilberto Simoni, because he's trying to look at a podium position at the end of this race, whereas people, he's having a very easy ride. Thank you very much. The gap now is 48 seconds between Basso on the left and Simoni on the right.
It continues to stretch, but Simoni is going to be increasingly concerned about the proximity of Gutiérrez, who isn't dropping away from the action here. There's a chance he could still climb up alongside Simoni. Simoni is looking to be best of the rest, if that's the way it's got to be. He wants a podium place, because if he can finish on the first three, as Gilberto Simoni will have been on the podium in the first three for the seventh time in his career. And that's got to be some sort of a record.
Well, you have to say that he really does love the Giro d'Italia. He loves the mountaintop finishes, and he would have been looking at a stage victory on a race like this afternoon if it hadn't been for this man in the pink jersey. And what a way to be in the Giro d'Italia. If you're Italian, leading the race of your own country with the pink jersey on your shoulders and riding to victory on one of the big mountain stages.
He just looks so comfortable. It's almost like a Sunday ride for him. He's just keeping a nice cadence. Look at the face here, the puffing and blowing of Gilberto Simoni. Oh, it hurts a little bit as well, as he now tries just to stay in front rather than catch up with the man in front.
Concentration, he's looking a long way up the road. It's not far off being the minute mark now as we go further back down the road to third and fourth place riders. This is José Enrique Gutiérrez. He's still going to keep himself up in second place overall, but he will now start to see himself being challenged by Gilberto Simoni, who now seems to be finding a little bit of respite. He seems to have recovered a fraction now. He's ticking the legs over quite quickly. You see the bike that he's got there. It's a special machine that he's had brought down here to the Giro. It's got pink corners to it to indicate to him that he, in fact, is, let's not forget, a former winner of the Giro d'Italia.
Yes, and it's on these sort of roads where he consolidated his victory when he did. But right now, he's on the receiving end of a very vicious Ivan Basso. Still, he hasn't lost Simoni's hooligans. They're all there to cheer him on.
Well, it was because of the Simoni hooligans a couple of years ago that Vladimiro Belli was ejected from the Giro d'Italia because they got in his way at the top of one of the nasty climbs, and he punched one of the supporters right on the nose. And unfortunately, he was spotted from the race helicopter. And that was Belli in the group there in the white jersey of Sella Italia.
That's right. He was sitting either third or fourth overall at the time, too, which is a shame. But here we are. Basso is thinking only of first place, where he has been since he took the race lead, with 14 days still to ride in the Giro this year. And he's not going to lose it now, barring a crash, that's for sure, because he's building once again on the eve of three more vicious days to come in the mountains, the Alps and the Dolomites, as we now continue looking back here at the group containing Damiano Cunego. Paolo Savardelli's in here as well. In fact, Savardelli is ahead of Cunego on that graphic.
But big gaps at 2 minutes and 40 seconds back to Savardelli. Cunego losing a little bit of time here this afternoon. But this is the man who I think today could very well be sealing his overall victory. And you're looking to be right, Phil, in the fact that the only thing I think now that can rob him of victory is a crash on the run in towards the roads of Milan. But let's not forget last year, all of this changed for Ivan Basso, because on one bad day in the mountains, he lost himself more than 45 minutes on a single stage.
Yes, he seems to have learned something from that, because he's certainly riding very, very confidently here.
Well, I think the thing that he probably learned is to make sure he keeps eating, and that's the important thing on a mountain stage. It's never easy to eat in a mountain stage like this, but whenever it's slightly easier, you've got to take on board food, take on board energy bars and energy drinks, just to make sure that you keep the energy levels topped up to perfection, because if you hit the wall on a mountain stage, you can lose so much time.
Well, the Tifosi are being treated to a great display here, display memorable of the big names of the past, like Coppi, Bartoli, even Eddie Merckx in the Giro d'Italia, because he won this race five times, as well as he now races up towards the line. And it looks as though Ivan Basso is just searching for a lot of time. It's going to be an enormous time gap overall by the end of today's stage. 1.9 kilometres now to climb. And still Simoni is holding off these two riders, but there is only seconds in it. But because of the hairpin bends, they can't see him.
They can't quite grasp the sight of Gilberto Simoni. I did see a little bit further down the road with Paolo Salvadelli. I think Danilo De Luca had recovered, and he was in that group with his teammate there, and his teammate was Andrea Noe. But of course, Salvadelli has got Checho Rubiera. There you can see the yellow card. There is Gilberto Simoni. Gutierrez is riding himself back into this race. He wants to hold on to his second place overall, and he too now wants to consolidate his time difference between all of the riders behind him.
Well, that's been a fabulous piece of climbing by José Gutiérrez, because he's had the gadfly stuck on his wheel there in Leonardo Pipli, who's doing just his teammate's job, and you bet your life he'll sprint for third place when he gets a shot at it too, if that's the way it's going to be. But Gutiérrez is racing for time. Third place is nothing. He wants the time because he really is in sight of a podium finish in the Giro. And just look at the way he's going. He's such a big man. I'm amazed he can climb quite as well as he can.
Big, powerful rider there, ticking out a very sensible rhythm, right on his wheel. Pipoli, I think, will try and sprint for third place if these riders survive in the positions that they are right now, because let's not forget there are time bonuses available for first, second and third riders to cross the line. Look at the gap. Ivan Basso, 1 minute and 18 seconds back to Gilberto Simoni. He really is walking away, and it's only around about 14 seconds between Simoni and Gutierrez.
That's why he's got to keep on going, Simoni. His second place on the day is far from assured here. This rider is first place on both the classification and the stage. He's definitely assured now. He's looking for the kilometre kite. But looking back at Gutierrez, he's well known in the States, at least I hope he is this year, because he finished fourth in the Tour of Georgia, that lovely state, and what a great race that is. And that's where he's found his form that's put him in such good condition for the Giro d'Italia. And he's continued to get on with the job in hand. He knows he's on a hiding to nothing from Pipoli if it comes to the sprint.
Well, it's not far away now from the final kilometre for the Maglia Rossa Ivan Basso. I just saw the sign at 1.2 kilometres to go, so very shortly he should go under the banner of the last kilometre of the race. And he's going to stretch himself a pretty set. There it is as he goes round the corner. It's slightly flatter now on the run in towards the finish. The wind is up. You can see the wind pushing those Italian flags right across the road. Simone is probably going to lose himself about a minute and 20 seconds on Ivan Basso, but pull time back on Damiano Cunego, pull time back on Paolo Salvadelli, and a little bit of time on José Enrique Gutiérrez.
You can hear the atmosphere here now with the Tifosi shouting on Ivan Basso. They've been watching a demonstration of absolute domination of this year's Giro d'Italia, and they're going to shout him all the way to the summit. He's never slowed down. With every pedal rev, he's pulling away from everybody. Same can't be said of Simoni over the two chasers. Here they are, still being shouted up the mountain. Remember that Gutierrez is a Spanish rider, and he's surrounded by Italian riders right now.
So This is Simoni in second place. The Tifosi are going absolutely crazy here this afternoon, encouraging the man who they've seen win the Giro d'Italia on two occasions. Gutierrez is trying to drag himself up to Simoni. He doesn't really need to catch him, that's not important. But what he does need to do is time gap the riders behind him to consolidate his chance of staying second overall on the race up towards Milano. But still the same cadence for Ivan Basso. It looks to me as if he's changed his position a fraction too, because he looks to be sitting rather low, and he may well have put his saddle down a little bit for the mountains to try and keep that cadence high and efficient.
Well, while Basso is about 300 metres from the finish, here we have Simoni at 1,000. So there you can see exactly how far ahead after all of that climbing Ivan Basso has gone. In fact, he was 500. So he's half a kilometre ahead of Gilberto Simoni, all taken in the last 7 kilometres of the climb. This is a great moment now for Ivan Basso. It'll be his second stage win. And again, he's going to beat everybody to the time bonuses.
Well, a half a kilometre on a mountaintop finish is equivalent to about 1.5 minutes, which is pretty funny because on the flat stages, the riders will cover the final kilometre, sometimes inside of 60 seconds.
Listen to the crowd now. Not quite as cold as it was the other day up here, but it's still a bit chilly. But here he comes, Ivan Basso, the man in pink, consolidating that jersey. It's going to be like a suit of armour now for the rest of this race. But will he falter over the next 3 days? You certainly wouldn't think so today, but there remain some very hard roads ahead. But he's made sure he's conquered this one as he races up towards the line, the last 100 metres. And Ivan Basso is going to look tonight, and I've said it before, but he'll need binoculars to see the rest of the race.
He certainly will. He'll have to wait a long time before the last man in the race comes home this afternoon, because some guys are going to lose themselves huge chunks of time.
Yeah. He doesn't look as though he's even sweated on the climb as he smiles there. 4:51 the time, clock has started. Hats off to Gutierrez, he's still climbing, doing all of the work. People, he'll nip him for third place, I'm sure of that. But he hasn't got up to Gilberto Simoni, who's done well.
Well, Simoni has hung on here. He was the last man to stay in contact with Ivan Basso at 400 metres to go. Just looks over his shoulder, a real seasoned professional. He's going to be 35 years of age at the end of this season. He's been around for a long time. And as you say, he's a seriously consistent performer when it comes to the Giro d'Italia. He's going to hold on for second place. And I think he could pull himself right up in the rankings with a ride like this afternoon.
Here he comes, dancing on those pedals to the summit. I think he'd be secretly inside pretty happy with this performance. Beaten by a superman today, but Simoni still able to do it despite his age. Gutierrez, go back 6 years when he broke his collarbone in this race. He also wore the pink jersey for a day. He's really worth third place. I think it might have to be fourth.
Simoni, just the last few metres for him now, and it's all a question of the clock. And look at the clock over on the right-hand side. 1:10 has already gone by since Ivan Basso crossed the line to get himself another stage victory in the Giro d'Italia. But this man is a fighter, Ivan Basso. He will not give up. This man, Simoni, is a fighter, I have to say. He won't give up. He'll clock in 1:26, I think he'll be given there. And that is a good performance by him. As you can see here, Gutierrez tries to get third.
Well, hats off to him. He's tried to hold off people. He must feel a little bit guilty at this, but he just gets him on the line. Not a big margin, considering he sat behind him the whole way up the climb.
Well, Gutierrez was not happy with that at all, but the job had to be done because there were time bonuses available. But the man of the day is Ivan Basso in the Maglia Rossa, the stage victory, and extending his lead once again.